colab.research.google.com. This is the Google version of Jupyter Notebook. And I have a sample of something that I was working on, fiddling around a few days back. It's not working, but just to give you an idea, you can click this, and again, the Google version of Jupyter Notebook actually opens up. So you can use whichever one you want.
Yeah. I'm sorry, can you copy the URL into the...
I'll do that in the meetup. So which one, the Azure Notebook one?
This URL.
So the Python syntax and the libraries that you'll be using work the same in both versions. The difference is when you're trying to do something that is more specific to a platform. For example, Google Cloud or Microsoft Azure. Let's suppose I have data in Microsoft Azure in some of their databases. So I'll be using the Azure library to actually go and fetch that data. If I have data in Bigtable on the Google Cloud platform, then I'll be using a Google library to actually go and retrieve that platform. So that's just a difference between which vendor you're going with. Otherwise, the actual Python code actually is the same. It behaves the same in both versions. So let's go. So I clicked on this link over here. It immediately opened up this library, and again, I'm hoping that everyone can see it in their laptops, because I know it's not that visible over here. But this is a Jupyter Notebook housed on Azure. I will be uploading this to, it's actually uploaded on GitHub as well, and we'll be sharing the links later on as well. So in addition to what you see over here, this code is going to be on GitHub as well. The idea is that let's go and try to visualize the data that we have done, that we are going to be using for these workshop series, the movie lens data set. And so let's go and visualize that. Let's understand what that data is about. Once we have an understanding, that's the kind of, then we can build some recommendation system of that data. So in order to do so, we first need to import some required packages. In this workshop series, we'll be using the more fundamental ones, the ones which are more popular, which everyone seems to be using, because they are so essential to do any kind of data engineering or any kind of data science. So we'll be using Pandas, we'll be using NumPy, and we'll be using Matplotlib. Sorry, it's a bit of a tongue twister. So these are the ones that we'll be using. Pandas is mostly used for data visualization. NumPy is numbers, Python. So it's used for some kind of mathematical computational work. So once you've imported the libraries, now you need to upload the data into Azure Notebooks. The data that we have, it needs to be uploaded on Microsoft Azure before it can be used. It needs to be present in your the Azure Notebook library folder that we just created or just have. Now, if you cloned my library, or my recommendation system solution that was there, then all the code and the files would all automatically appear in your library as well. But let's suppose if you're doing this from scratch, if you're starting off new, then the first thing that you need to do is upload some data. There are two ways of uploading the data. So you can go over here and you can say that I need to, I'm in my library folder, I click new. And I'll actually say that please upload some file from a URL or from the computer and give it this option, and those files will then be uploaded. So for example, in my case, all these data files are not uploaded over here, and now my notebook can actually access these files. The other option that I have is I do it within the notebook itself. So in the notebook, I go to data, and you can see upload or download, so I click on upload. It tells me, okay, what do you want to upload? You give me a folder, and I'll go from there. So there are two actually ways of uploading that. So that's the second step. Upload the data, get data on Azure Notebooks. It's very similar to uploading stuff on the cloud. So if I'm running a program on the cloud that is accessing a local cloud storage, I first need to bring stuff into the cloud storage, right? So same idea over here. Now that I've my files, my data files present in my cloud storage, in my Azure notebook, I should start loading it in my data frame. A data frame is basically, you know, a table that you load data in so that you can actually use it as part of your programming. So you can actually do different kinds of operations on top of that. So in order to do so, I'll use the, you know, read CSV form a syntax over here. The location that I give is actually the location that I have my data is present over here. So /home/mbuser, this is, you know, me. This is who I am. Accessing the location. /library, because my data is present in the /library/uinfo. So this is the location that my data is going to be present. It's probably going to be the same for everyone as well, because, you know, you cloned my recommender folder, so it's going to be similar to you as well. So this is where the file is actually present. This file does not have a header, so that's why the header is none. And the separator, because it's a CSV file, the separator is actually a space between two fields or two columns. So this is a format. It's going to load this file in this data frame, df_u_info. And I've done this for all six files. So the second file is df_user. This is u.user. And over here, the separator is actually one of these pipes. So that is why you see a separator pipe over here. It's actually a space. And in some cases, I actually have the tab as a separator, because this is how the files are formatted. It's not my brain, this is how the data was present. So, you know, when I download it, I actually have to take a look and see what the separators were, whether they actually had headings or not. So based on that, I put in these different parameters, and I'm including all of these data into data frames. So in order to run this, what you do is, let's start at the beginning. I'm going to point over here. I know it's not that visible, but you can look at it in your notebook. There's something called N, and there are square brackets over here. This basically means this is a cell that is an input to the notebook that is going to be processed. So if you go over there, select that cell, now it's selected, and you click the run button. So what that does is the Jupyter kernel actually is going to run the code in that cell. All of this is actually a cell, but you know, the advantage of having Jupyter Notebook is that you can actually put HTML markup text over here. So in fact, I'll show you the HTML markup text. So let me double click this line and let's see what comes up. This is an HTML markup text. So H1, the heading, and then, you know, /H1 for closing over there. So that's a closing tag. I can change this. Introduction to recommendations as well from this. I just changed this. Now when I run this over here, if I run this, this cell is going to be executed. It knows it's actually a markdown cell, because there's actually a drop down over here. You can actually select whether this is a code or a markdown. So when I run this, it knows that this is actually a markup text. It is going to run that, and the heading actually changes. Let me show you another cell. This animated image that you actually see, this is actually an image that is linked on Azure Notebook site. So let me just double click this. This is actually the code that is being executed over here. See this? So this is again an HTML markup image source. This is the source of the image, and if I click on the source, you can actually see what's not up in another tab. This is an image that is actually running the background. So I did not upload any image. I just pointed this text. I just pointed this HTML saying that there's an image over there displayed over here. And if you want to see, I just run this again. And now that cell was converted into this image. So this is how Jupyter Notebook runs. And I like this because a lot of these programming assignments, you're thinking out loud, so the comments just doesn't help you enough. You want to have some more deeper explanations. You want to have some diagrams. I may sketch something. I may take a do a sketch and then take a picture and then just upload it, insert it into my Jupyter Notebook. In fact, I've done assignments where rather than providing supplementary documents or a presentation, you put everything in Azure Notebook, because, you know, people find it such more useful. So this is what it is. So let's start running each one of these cells. So this is the first cell, I'll run it. There's nothing over there. Obviously, it's just a Markov text. Nothing happens. Then the next cell is selected. I run this. Then this cell is also again Markov text. Nothing happens. And I get to this cell. And there's an in over here. So this is because this is a code cell. So over here, if you look at it, it actually changes to code rather than markdown. So when I run this cell, this code is going to get executed. So run this. There's a star over here, and this star is then going to quickly change. When that statement is executed, when the cell actually gets executed, that star changes into a number. Right now, it's probably one for most of you, because this is the first code cell that you've run, so a one comes. Sometimes it'll be two, sometimes five or ten or whatever. Depends on the sequence that you've executed. And please let me know if I'm going to too many basics, because I don't know the similarity of the audience between two. So let's just keep running the cell. So that cell got executed. The next one, this gets executed. This is all text, so nothing is happening. Now we come to this cell. This is where you're actually loading the data from the cloud storage, the Azure notebook cloud storage, into the local data frames, that the local variables, if you will, that you're going to be using. So let's run this. It takes a few seconds. Yeah, and now it ran. I've actually commented this one out, so if you uncomment, you may actually have a problem, because there was some problem with the separator or the file. There was some error in the file. So when it was reading it, I actually complained that, this is not working, I can't read it properly. So I commented that out. I'll fix it later. So now I have all of these files, this data set loaded in my local variables. Now we can start doing something interesting with this data. So let's analyze the data frame. This statement, type, it gives you what kind of data frame was just loaded, or this variable that you have, this df_uinfo, it tells you what type of variable this is. So let's run this. I get this line over here, out. And it actually has again a number, and this is the output. So this actually represents, this is the input to the cell that was given to be executed, and this is the output of that cell. So the output of that is, if this is a data frame type, so that is just simple output. So whatever variable, if you want to see what kind of variable this is, using the type keyword actually tells you the kind of variable that you have. Now I have five different files that I've loaded into data frames. Let's see what columns each file actually contains. So let's select the first one. I have this file called df_u_user. I want to see what were the columns, because these files actually had headings. So let's just, I commented the second one because I'm doing them one after the other. So let's run this. And it gave me, these are the index that it actually found, or the columns that it actually found. So user ID, age, gender, occupation, zip code. So in this file, u.user, these are the columns that are present. So let's try the next one. I'm going to comment out the first line and uncomment out the next one, and run df_u_data. This is the transaction data. This actually file contains all the transaction data. So let's run it and see what kind of columns I have. So it says that this transactional data file actually has a user ID, it has an item ID, it has a rating, it has a timestamp. So when a user purchased an item, he or she rated that item, right, 3-star, 4-star, whatever, and the time at which that rating actually occurred. So this actually is my transactional data file. This is where all of my information is stored. That is going to be very useful for me to come up with suitable recommendations. Let's do some more stuff for the data files that we just uploaded, the data frames. I need to see the information that is present in each one of these files. Let's take a look at sample records. I'm going to comment out each one of these and just take the first one. So if I run this cell, it's the head basically means that it's going to return the number of a few rows from the top of the file. The start of the file. So if I run this, it actually is going to show me a few items from this. So this file just had like three rows, so just return three. Let's take one of the bigger ones. let's take, instead of this, let's type U. So this is df underscore u underscore data dot head. This is the largest file. It has 100,000 vectors in it. So let's run it and see. Top five rows. So this is what it showed me. It gave me the top five rows or the first five rows. You can see the row ID, the user ID. This is a user ID. So each user would have a unique ID. For example, I would have a unique ID in Amazon system. That's the ID. This is the item that I was giving a rating against. For example, I was reading a book. I gave that book a rating of 3, and this is the time that actually I gave. This is the timestamp, and this timestamp is, in this case, is from epoch time, so 1st January 1970 start of time. I think that is the unit epoch time. So this is the idea. Let's suppose instead of 5 rows, I want to see 100 rows. So I go here and say 100. Hold on, it will give me the first 100 rows. So you can fool around with this just to see how many. The kind of data that we want to see, so that it comes up over here. 100 rows and 4 columns. Okay. If I want to see the rows from the bottom of the file, or the bottom of the tail, the scene, I can type instead of head, I can type tail. So df underscore u underscore data, let's suppose if I type data, and say last 10 rows. It gives you the last 10 rows. You can see that the sequence number goes all the way to 100,000. So it's showing you the last 10 rows in that data frame. So this is one way of looking at the data, peeking into the data. If I don't give head or tail and I just run it like this, if I just keep the name of the variable, it's going to display the contents of that variable. In this case, it's a data frame. So I use df underscore u underscore occupation because it doesn't have that many rows. If I run this, it shows me all the rows over there. So there were 20 rows and it gave me all of the data. So let's get to some more interesting things. So this was just the data frame that we have some information in data in, and we are trying to do some fiddling around just to see the kind of columns that exist, the rows that are present over there. Let's do some analysis. So, you know, a lot of aggregate level analysis can be done in SQL. So, you know, when you're connected using SQL to a database, you can run SQL queries and you can do group by and you can do all kinds of different joins to get some information. You can do the same kind of things over here in Python as well, using pandas or using even simple Python statements. For example, let's suppose I want to see out of these 100,000 records that I have in this data set, I want to see all of them aggregated by the rating. So you know, the ratings are 0 or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I want to see how many records are rated 1, how many are rated 2, how many are rated 3 and 4 and 5 in such a way. So it's fairly simple to do in SQL query. And it's fairly simple to do in Python as well. So just write the data frame, give the index that you want, like in this case rating, and say dot count and run it. Oops. I didn't do a group myself, just whether actually the around this thing. This is the correct one. So the number of items by rating, that's what I want to see. So I run this cell. And voila, it is. So there are 6,110 items which are rated 1. And there are 11,370 items which are rated 2 and low. And then rating 3 has 27,000, rating 4 has 34,000. And rating 5 is 21,000. So again, something you can do with SQL query as well, but you can also do that in Python as well on Jupyter Notebook. The good thing is that you get your output over here very quickly and very interactively. I can do different things as well. This was how many items are there for each rating type or each rating number. Let's do it the other way around. Which item how many? Okay, so it's written over here. Count the number of ratings given for each movie item. So for each movie item, I want to see how it's rated. So let's run this. I just flipped the numbers around. What I'm trying to show is a combination of items. So you can group by item ID and count the rating for that item. So you know this is how it actually returns the results. It's not a very useful case, but it just shows you a combination of items, how you can actually do so. So what I'm trying to show is that this item one in this transaction history has been rated 452 items. It's probably a popular item. The rating could be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, doesn't matter, but it has been rated 452 times. Item number 15 in this entire catalog of things has been rated 293 times. So it's probably one of the more popular things. But you have items which have not been rated that often. For example, some of the numbers over here. Item 1659, this has just been rated once. You can go and figure out why is that the case. Why is it not coming up in people's searches, or why is it not coming in people's pages? So that, you know, probably that's why it's not being rated. So these are things that you can actually do to uncover trends in your data. This is a little more complicated. Over here, what I've done is, in order to see this huge result, I said, let me try to sort it first and just get the top five records. So you can actually cascade a lot of these parameters. There's a count, reset index, sort values, ascending, right? It can all be added to this data frame and executed over here. So the same thing that we just saw before, but this is sorted. So highest item number 50 was the highest rated item, and there it was rated 583 times. So this actually can actually uncover some more items. So these are the most popular items or the most highly rated items. So I have some other examples like this. You can do the mean, you can do the standard deviation, but I think we're running out of time, so I'll move on to the plots. Let's try to create some basic plots, some visualization of the data. So if I want to create a simple histogram, I can just say plot. Histogram plot is the map plot of a lib library. So use that and say I want to create a histogram based on the rating. Just type that, give it the index, give it the data frame, give it the index, and it creates a histogram. Let's say I want to do something slightly different, where I want the movie items, the histogram based on the movie items rather than the rating. So I just give the indexes and I give the count, and you know, here's the histogram for that as well. So you can see everything is coming up in line. So it's very easy to actually go in and visualize the data that you actually have. It makes it a lot more interesting. You don't have to write a lot of queries. You don't have to connect to a database. Everything is in line. If you've brought in the data, and now you're just analyzing the data. And Python actually supports large data volumes as well. Like I just brought 100,000 vectors in front of you. It happened within a couple of seconds. In addition to histograms, there are actually many, many different supported types. You have scatter plots, you have time series, you have bar charts, you have box charts. You have a whole slew of different ways of visualization, and these are just part of the basic package. If you go for more advanced visualization techniques, the packages, you can do amazing type of things. So let's try to do time series visualization. So people rate movies over time. I want to see how is my rating actually happening, and when are the times when people actually would rate movies higher as opposed to lower. Let's suppose, you know, during the course of the week, people are, you know, you're going through Monday blues, you're more grumpy, maybe you're more critical of the movies. Whereas on the weekend, you know, people are generally in a more relaxed mood, then the average rating actually increases. So, you know, let's do some visualization to uncover that kind of trend. So this is a time series visualization. I'll plot the rating by time step. So on my x-axis, I'll have the time step, because time is usually denoted on the x-axis, and the rating is basically going to be on my y-axis. So I run this, and I get a rating which is rather new. Oh, because
e to the 8th.
Because actually I did give it a large sample step, I should have given that. Let me start from the beginning. So I take that out, the head keyword completely, I run this, and this is what I get. So this is all the 100,000 items which have been rated by timestamp. And these are the number of it. So this actually, this peak or this vertical, this y-axis is actually the number of ratings. And this is over time, over the period at which all of this data was being captured. So you can see that periods where people actually are very prolific in rating things, and there are periods where people don't actually rate anything at all. You know, these are the kinds of all the things that could be uncovered. Instead of rating, I could do, instead of count, I could do something like a mean over here to show the, instead of the count of ratings over time, the average rating that varies. Let's see if this actually works. So we have, but the problem is there's so much data over here that it's difficult to see. So let's change this. Let's just put the top 10, top 100, 1,000. So I just had 1,000 over here. So I just want the first 1,000 records. So it's difficult to, so it's easier to see. And you see now I get some interesting results. So over this period of time, you can see the average rating, because I'm doing a mean, the average rating is going up and down. So you'd expect the individuals to consistently rate movies, right? But you see the areas, the points in time where people are more happy with the kind of movies that they see, and then there are periods others where they're actually quite upset with the same kind of movies. Probably, you know, people could dig into that a little deeper and try to see why that is the case. And maybe normalize the data. Maybe this is not normalized, so maybe some normalization is required. So that's time series, and there are other types of mechanisms of plotting as well. One last one that I'll cover right now is because I want to finish at 8:30 so that we can mingle and have time to go through different questions or even just try to move some more things. One more last is scatter plots. Scatter plots, I really like scatter plots because it shows when you're trying to lay your data out on a single two-dimensional graph using two axes or maybe even more if you can squeeze that in, is it shows you how your data is actually spread over a flat surface. And that is usually quite revealing. So what I did over here is there are a few lines because I needed to first, when I try to do a simple scatter plot on, let's suppose, item ID and rating, I wanted to see which items are rated better. So maybe there may be a cluster of items which are rated generally higher and a cluster of items which are not rated very high. The data did not give me very good results, so I abandoned that use case. Then I tried to do it by individual. I was like, maybe there are individuals who are very optimistic or generally very positive individuals and they rate everything on a 4 or a 5. And there are people who are a little more grumpy and they rate everything on a 1 or a 2. And I just wanted to differentiate between those two types of groups, people who generally consistently rate things high and people who generally consistently rate things a little low. But that did not come up in my data as well. So I was like, okay, what do I do? Because I really wanted to show scatter plot today. So I did this some fiddling around where I'm actually taking users by rating. I'm trying to get the mean to see generally, so for example, as an individual, if I rated 100 Netflix movies, I want to get the mean of my rating. So is it going towards the higher side? Is it going towards the lower side? So I get that. I load it into a variable. This is actually a series that, just like your data frame, you actually have a series type as well. So I got it over there because this actually returns a series output. And then I had to convert that back into a data frame as well so that I could plot it. So these four lines just do that. They take this output over here. And just the first 500 rows, otherwise the scatter plot gets too dense. And they take this portion, store it into a series, and then this series is then converted into a data frame back over here through these two lines. And then I give some columns over there so I can use these columns when I call the plot. User ID and M rating stands for mean rating. And now finally, after I've got this done, I execute this code. I have this, so now I can do a scatter plot. This is my scatter. And this is my user ID. So over here we have user IDs from 0 to 500, because remember I just took the first 500. By changing this number I can get more, I can get 1,000 users or so. And this is the mean rating that each person has been given. So user number 1 gave this, user number 2 gave this. So you can see there is some trends. There are individuals who are generally rating movies low, and there are individuals who are generally rating things high because that's what the mean actually represents, right? So you can see that. One thing that can also be done, by the way, is have a size. In scatter plots, these dots, all of them are the same. So this dot would mean one movie rated by this individual, right? whereas this dot would mean 100, the mean rating of 100 movies. You can actually change the size of these dots to represent that as well, whether this is based on one count or whether this is based on 100 counts. So that is also a way of representing this information. So you can have a third dimension as well in the scatter plot, the size dimension. But you know, this is basically some experiments that we've done, trying to get a better understanding of the data. You can do it in really other ways as well. You can use one of these data visualization tools like Tableau. You can write your own SQL queries if you have that background of trying to understand that. Or you could do that entirely in Python. I come from a very strong database development background. I used to do a lot of SQL. I've written a SQL query which has been 5 to 6 pages long, just one single query. I used to write complete applications in SQL query because that was something that I really liked doing. It was more of an intellectual thing than a required thing to do. But after I did stuff on Python, you know, the data visualization Python, I think this is just so much more convenient because it lets you churn out code at a very rapid frequency. So that's all that I had. I think we are right on time, but I'm around for half an hour. If you want to ask questions on Jupyter Notebook, on Azure Notebook, if you want to file different things, or just generally if you want to ask some questions, and also I appreciate if you would give us some feedback as well. Either you could send it directly to me, let directly me know. Or if it's positive, just post it on the Meetup group as well. If it's negative, just let us know directly. But no, we really need to hear back from you, positive or negative, because we'd like to improve this on an ongoing thing. We want to really invest time in having this Meetup fulfill the needs of this community, the Waterloo tech community, on recommendation systems, on chatbots, on NLP, on other aspects of this. And we want to spend some consumer time in developing this. So feedback is really, really helpful for us. Thank you. Can you say something?
How is error reporting straightforward? You know, if you make, let's say, a Python error.
Mm-hmm. It's a little convoluted, but you know, Stack Overflow has an answer for everything. So let's suppose if I just omit the closing bracket over there and I run this. So it gives me an error, unexpected end of file EOF while passing some indicator. If I don't give it the right parameter, let's suppose I do this and just say kindly instead of kind. So scatter plot is a type of a plot. So kind is equal to scatter, but instead of kind, I type kindly. Let's say run this. It gives me this convoluted error, but towards the end, if I go and see what actually it means, because it gives a complete stack trace, it says unknown property kindly. So I know, oh no, kindly is probably wrong. Maybe I should go and fix it. I fix this and then I run, and it works again. So that error actually is there, if it's something that it can detect. At times it's convoluted, but then you know, Stack Overflow really helps on those occasions. Yeah.
So a question, so there was a table there where there are 5 rows of different customers with, I think it was like 4 attributes,
mm-hmm.
4 columns. But, and then this information is being analyzed to better kind of make recommendations, right?
Mm-hmm.
So my question is, how would we know what for an optimal recommendation, how many attributes are required, right? Like for here, for example, here there's, I think there's 4, but what is required, 4, 20, 100,
mm-hmm.
How do we get to that?
So that's where data engineering and feature engineering actually come in. For example, you do principal component analysis just to see whether all aspects of this required, or can I actually, even if they return a better result, things are computationally expensive. You don't want your model running for 2 hours when it can be giving you 90% of accuracy with a reduced set of data and run in just and be trained in just 2 minutes. So these are things that you would actually do as part of feature engineering.
How do you separate good results from overfitting?
So that's interesting. One way that hopefully we'll actually do next week, in fact,
kind of show you that in this data set, we actually see that there are a number of files of it, and I'll just point out the way. The reason they've actually done that is actually split this data set, this 100K records, into multiple smaller chunks. And the idea is that you would actually train and test your model against each chunk separately, so that your model doesn't overfit to a particular data set. So this is one way that I know of that, that hopefully we'll try out next time we meet.
So like on K-fold cross validation.
Yeah.
And what if
and they have a 5-folds over here. Yeah, 5.
And let's say you were to do classification. Let's say you want to classify dogs and cats, but your data sets are unbalanced. Let's say you have 80%
cats
and 20% dogs. And what's the metric that you use to evaluate that this classifier is useful and not just purely based on like chances? Can you use Kappa coefficient to determine that?
So what do you think, Katie?
Also,
yeah, we'll probably go that.
Yeah.
But
okay.
Yeah. We'll get back to you on that. Yeah.
Okay.
We'll probably try that out too. Maybe look at those scenarios as well.
Yeah, because like most of the time in real life, you just get unbalanced data set all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And I have a question about the time series.
This data set actually is unbalanced because I was looking through it and I was doing some data visualization. So it'll be an interesting experiment to try out. Because, you know, when we did certain counts and we were trying to display that as well, there were some items which were overrepresented than others. So yeah, maybe a good idea to actually try that out as well. So you have another question? Someone raise their hand.
The library you are using, are Python specific, or there are like the Azure notebook APIs too for specific for data science?
So these ones are Python specific, but some of these libraries actually come, other libraries actually have wrappers, for example, C++. So you could do the same kind of code in C. So you could write C++ code, call the same libraries, but through the C++ wrappers. So there, some of them actually exist as well. Yeah.
And the help for using the APIs, you have to search it on the web, yeah?
Yeah. So like, for example, pandas is something that, you know, this it's expanding at such a great degree that it's difficult for people to keep track. So I constantly have to go back and look at the documentation because there's so many different combinations available. So, yeah.
I do have one more question.
Mm-hmm.
So from a practical point of view, unless you're still answering the
question. Yeah, but I was just going to point this out. For example, if I were to do a merge of two data frames, I would do different objects. So all of that documentation is here. So the reference is quite heavy because it's very difficult to remember all of this. Yeah. So whenever I need to do something, I'll go back to the documentation.
Yeah. So as an entrepreneur starting, let's say, a technology company, and they know that they like to use recommendation systems. This whole, as we had talked about niche engineering, is this something the founder would have to think foresight with as to what features to look into, or would they be consulting with, let's say, an engineer as to what features you want?
So hopefully the data would reveal that hopefully the widgets will not have to be asked, and the data will be by itself. And that's where you would apply the feature to figure that out. Because you want the data to actually tell you whether it's valid and so on, different methods or analysis or not. So maybe you take the proof so we can Google for a few months?
Sorry?
Maybe take the proof so we can Google for a few months?
Can you work offline, or you have to be always online?
In this case, you have to be online because it is connected to the Azure Notebooks backend. But if you install your own, then you can actually do it on your computer offline.
To install the Python?
So there's an application called a distribution called Anaconda.
And then you have
I don't.
Kind of complex logic.
Yeah.
Look at that picture.
Yeah. And then make sure that you take Python 2 or Python 3, depending on the one that we need.
Yeah. So this is the distribution that you can download, and it has all of these packages. And it's easy to set it up.
But you'll not have the notepad features, yeah.
Based on that, you can then actually select Jupyter to install, so that you can actually work with Jupyter.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So this distribution actually contains all of these libraries and tools. It's all part of one package. So rather than, you can install it individually, but that's a lot of very painful, so it's better just to download one and that would set up all of this.
What version of Python is this?
You can do either 2.7 or 3.
Okay.
This one over here, it actually shows you right over here. So this is Python 3.6. I believe when I created this notebook, it asked at that time what version of Python you want, and gave it like Python 3.6. But I think it's at the start of the notebook.
Okay.
So is this the same as Jupyter.org? Is this the same platform?
What Microsoft's version of Jupyter, yes.
Okay.
So thank you very much for coming. We will be checking for setting up the next one somewhere in February, not the last week. I'm not here then, but we will find a good time. So hopefully you like the space here, so that we can keep doing it here. In a few months, Terminal will be moving to above Guild, so then we have a bigger meeting space available there, so it would be good. So, okay. And thank you all for coming, and have a safe trip back home.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.